start the last and final session. So usually a question which is asked frequently is, how did my father's journey start in this direction? So we all had one starting point which inspired us to dig deeper into all this. But for him, how did it start is a question which many people ask him or ask me when they meet me. So this all started way back in 86, 87. So my father was in the US, and I think all of you have the experience of having regular monthly checkups, yearly checkup, medical checkup, the whole body being screened by the companies. It's a requirement in your company. So for the same purpose, he was at a medical center waiting for his turn to go through the process of the medical checkup. And he is a person who cannot sit quiet. He has to keep talking to everyone, whoever is around. He just has to start some conversation with them. So in the waiting room, there was a young girl. Touching the mic. Okay. Fine? Okay. So there was a young girl, probably 6 to 8 years old. So he just asked the mother who was waiting there, why are you here? So for what purpose are you visiting the doctor? So the mother said that my daughter is having bleeding and we are unable to stop the bleeding, and that's why I'm here for the third or fourth time with consulting the doctor, and we are out of ways to control her bleeding. So first it didn't strike to him. He's like, what kind of bleeding? She didn't seem to be injured. But then she said it was menstrual bleeding. So this was a shocking event, which was the turning point which initiated him to look for what is wrong in what we are doing. Because back in India, from where he had recently moved, the age of menstruation was 14, 15, 16 years. That was when girls used to attain menarche. But here there was a 6 to 8 year old girl who had attained menarche already, and they were unable to stop the bleeding, and they were even considering removing the uterus at such a young age in the girl in order to save her life, because she was bleeding, almost becoming anemic, and it might put her life in danger. So this was the turning point. So there was something wrong which was being done. In the 1980s in India, it was still 15, 16 years, the age of menarche. Unfortunately, by the time we came back here and started the process in India, it slowly receded. And now even in India, it's reached 9 to 10 years of age. The usual age of menarche has receded to 9 to 10. So these young girls who have not yet even seen the world, are attaining sexual maturity. So it is an alarming thing. And this is when he started looking for the reason behind it. And this is how it led into milk, led into meat, and led into all the other foods which we are using, the processed foods, which are in a way responsible for the diseased states that we are in now. So with that, we will talk about milk. I think yesterday when we visited the Goshala and saw the A2 cows, we discussed a little about A1 and A2 milk. So what is the difference between A1 and A2 milk? Both have, the milk contains casein, a protein, and within this protein. So what is a protein? It is a unit, amino acids linked together make a protein. The same way that glucose molecules attach together to form a complex carbohydrate or starch, a protein is made of smaller units of amino acid. So in the 68th position, if I'm not wrong, there is one change where instead of proline, there is histidine amino acid. And this makes all the difference, because when it enters inside your body, there is a substance called BCN7 which is produced. It breaks inside the body and forms this substance, which is similar, very similar to the substance present in opium. It is an opioid-like substance. So the health effects of this substance start from intolerance to milk, like vomiting, diarrhea, indigestion caused when some people have milk, to as severe as type 1 diabetes. A1 milk has been linked to type 1 diabetes and even autism. So autistic children are increasing, we already talked about that. And one of the causes is also the presence of A1 milk. So A1 milk is produced by the Jersey cows, the hybrid cows. So first we have done the step of eliminating all the A1 milk which is now widely available in the market. So the next step we come to, what about A2 milk? So A2 milk is produced by our desi cows. We already looked into the environmental aspect, so I'm going to build upon that now. So there are 1.3 billion people. Say we use just 1/2 liter of milk per head per day, in the form of coffee, tea, in the form of milk, paneer, cheese, etc., etc. So how many cows would you require? A desi cow gives approximately 2 to 4 liters of milk per day. So let us keep the maximum 4 liters. So with this 4 liters, saying 1/2 liter per head, we have 8 people. Okay, let us take, for simplifying purposes, 10. So one cow can supply milk for 10 people on an average. So with 1.3 billion people, if the demand is so high, we need 130 million desi cows in to be able to produce the milk required. Do we have the resources to feed 130 million cows is the question. And this is if we completely neglect the fact that the cow is producing milk for its own calf. If we give the milk which we should to the calf and take only the remaining milk, this will almost become double. So we are depriving the calf of its milk, consuming all the milk ourselves, and then we need this many cows. So approximately, if to produce 1 kg of cow's meat, let's not convert it into meat, I'm saying just to feed it, you need equivalent to 16 kg of grains. So which, if you convert the grains to feed it into a cow, you'll need 16 kgs of it for producing 1 kg of the meat of the cow. So in order to stay alive, each cow weighs how many kgs? It's quite a heavy animal. So that many kgs of grain you will be feeding it on a regular basis. To produce this, we again require so much of our resources, so much land, so much water. So it is not ecologically viable for us to be consuming the amount of milk if we have to switch over to the desi cows. So what is happening now is the A1 milk which is being produced, first thing, the A1 cows produce more quantity of milk, and in order to increase the milk production, they are injected with steroids. Which include oxytocin, which include growth hormone, which include prolactin. So we'll now mix a little bit of the female topic which we were to discuss. So in the brain is located The hypothalamus. Also the pituitary. Both of these are the master glands. Pituitary is the master gland, and what controls the master gland is the hypothalamus. So I already mentioned that all the hormones in the body are required in a gentle balance, and the balance is what is most important. So the hypothalamus produces gonadotropin releasing hormone, which acts on the pituitary and stimulates it to produce two hormones in pituitary produces many more hormones, but in relation to the reproductive system, FSH and LH. FSH is follicle stimulating hormone, LH is luteinizing hormone. So this follicle stimulating hormone then acts on the ovary. Very rough diagram. I'm not a very good artist. So this is the ovary, the fallopian tube, and the uterus. So every month what happens is the follicle stimulating hormone stimulates the follicles which are present in the ovary. So at birth it is already present in the ovary, the follicles. Every month a few of them, 1, 2, 3 of them, start developing in response to the follicle stimulating hormone released by the pituitary. And one of them develops and then releases the ovum. In the process, the developing follicle releases the hormone estrogen. After the ovum is released, the remnant is going to produce progesterone. And it is so beautifully designed in the body that the same estrogen and progesterone are going to have a negative feedback on the hypothalamus and on the pituitary to reduce the secretion of these hormones. So as long as estrogen and progesterone levels are in a particular level, the process does not repeat itself. So progesterone's role is mainly to prepare the body for pregnancy. So if the ovum which is released is fertilized in the fallopian tube, then there is a nice cozy cushion bed which is being formed inside the uterus to receive the fertilized ovum and allow it to develop. But if this process does not take place within the next 14 to 15 days after the ovum is released, if fertilization has not occurred, then the progesterone which was being secreted starts to drop, and that is when the cushion bed which was being produced gets broken down and is coming out of the body in the form of menstrual blood. It is very sad that most people are unaware of this basic anatomy and physiology, though it is happening right within our body. We are unaware of what menstrual cycles are, what the menstrual flow is. There are people who come with the problem of infertility. They have been taking treatment for it from 5 years, 6 years, and yet they do not know when is the right time when they need to have intercourse in order to conceive. They do not know that at all. They have visited so many doctors, but that basic information has not been given to them. All that is given is medicines, injections, scans, reports. They have a big file, but the basic information of what is happening inside the body is not given. So this is the problem. We need to educate ourselves. We need to be informed of what is happening inside. So I was talking about the menstrual cycle. So as long as this is happening, as long as progesterone and estrogen are, the levels are in a certain level, they are going to have a negative feedback mechanism, and this is going to not happen till the next cycle. So when progesterone level falls, then again hypothalamus gets an impulse to start gonadotropin releasing hormone again, increase the secretion, and again the cycle continues. So anywhere if there is some imbalance in any of this hormone, the whole process gets upset. So now you see how easy it is to disrupt the balance, because at any step there are so many multiple hormones involved, such a balanced formula which is happening. So what happens is during pregnancy, prolactin hormones and oxytocin hormones suppress this whole cycle from happening. So when you're already pregnant, you don't want new eggs to be released. When you are lactating, a mother who is lactating at least for 6 to 8 months does not have her menstrual cycle again. So it is a natural contraceptive period. So during that period, what is preventing all this? It is the lactating hormones, which is prolactin, and also the oxytocin, which is released by the body in order for milk to be ejected from the body. So these hormones are already present in a high quantity in the cow's milk which we are consuming, prolactin, and of course the growth hormone, which is not at all suitable for the human body. The hormones in a cow's milk is suitable for the calf's growth, not for the human growth. So it will always cause an imbalance in the human hormone system. So when this happens, we are suppressing the hormone balance, and because of this is the most common problem for women now, PCO, polycystic ovaries. So what is polycystic ovaries? The follicles, one or two, are supposed to develop each month and release an egg. But what happens? Because of the hormone imbalance, multiple follicles start developing, but none of them release an egg. So all of them form water-filled bubbles called as cysts in the ovaries. So the whole process is not happening correctly, and it is directly can be linked to the introduction of hormones from a very young age. So the sex hormones are supposed to kick in at puberty, but we are introducing it, I say, right from day one in many children. So mother's milk is not available. Readily available is the packeted powdered milk nowadays, or the cow's milk which we are giving to the children. So what happens is these hormones start entering the body at such a tender age, and they induce early menarche and they cause PCO. So what is the problem with early menarche, some may ask? So first thing, there is obviously the sexual change is happening at such a young age, including attraction towards the opposite sex at such a young age, which is not a good thing. And another major factor is, as I already said, the number of follicles is limited. It is already present at birth. So by the time, and now we also see late marriages and people going in for children at a later age, they're almost 29, 30, 32 when they're opting to have children. And menarche has already started at 8, 9, 10 years. So by that time, most of the healthy eggs are already consumed. What is left over are unhealthy eggs. So at this, because of this happening, we lead to the next major problem. infertility. So first thing, they're not having their cycles regularly. What happens in PCOD? 2, 3, 4, 5 months, no cycles. Or when the cycle appears, there is incessant bleeding. Or it might also lead to cycles once in 15 days. But these cycles may be anovulatory, without an egg being produced, just menstrual bleeding happening. So that is one cause for infertility. And the quality of the eggs left when they are trying for conception is low. And of course, on the other hand, in men, sir was saying, speak about men as well. Men also have a lot of problems. So introduction of female kind of hormones into men, what effect does this have? So it is these sex hormones which make a difference between a man's nature and a woman's nature, a man's body structure and a woman's body structure. So the whole difference between men and women is basically because of the correct hormone balance being present in them. So when female hormones are introduced into a male body, which it shouldn't have been there, one direct effect we are seeing in young boys is development of breast. It has become very common of late for boys to have breast development. Another thing which is happening is an imbalance in this hormone causes low sperm count. So again, that is adding to the problem of infertility. Both the men and the women are not having a healthy sperm or a healthy egg to be conceiving, and so that is the reason why infertility clinics are coming up in each and every street. And how much do they charge? It is, they use the weakness of the people to the desire to have their own child, and they charge heavily, 3 lakhs, 4 lakhs for every session, and there is no guarantee that it will be successful. Very less rate chances of it being a success. And then we have the next problem of maintaining a normal pregnancy and having a normal delivery. The mothers are already weak. They have deficiency of iron, deficiency of calcium, deficiency of so many nutrients, and obviously they are not able to provide the right environment required for the baby's development. And this is a reason why we are having children with very low immunity, children with multiple problems. The age at which problems are starting has just been receding. And pregnancy, which is a natural phenomenon, is now being considered like a disease. Once you are pregnant, you need bed rest. That is how it has become. You are not capable of doing any work. When women have been become so weak and are treated in this way, it is almost next to impossible to have a normal delivery. You need to be strong, you need to have stamina, you need to have muscle strength, you need to have good lung capacity to withstand labor and to be able to push out the baby. And along with that, we have the most unscientific way of conducting a delivery, that is lying perpendicular to the gravity. What does gravity do? It helps pull anything downward. Anything which is thrown up comes down because of gravitational force. So it would naturally imply that if a lady is in this position, gravitation will aid the birth of the child. It will help pull the child down. But for our convenience, we have made it on a perpendicular level to the gravity. So the act force is this way and we have to push this way. It is very, very difficult. Earlier, in even today, if you go to tribal regions, deliveries are conducted with the lady holding a rope which is hanging from the top, and below there is a cushioned, what do you say, what we use for winnowing, yeah, that is used with a cloth kept in it. That was the most scientific way, but we have eliminated that and made it convenient for the doctors but difficult for the patients. I shouldn't call them patients, for the mothers to push out the baby. So cesarean has become normal and normal has become so rare. So I wanted to share what an incident which happened in my yoga class. So one of the students who was with me in my yoga class, she said that she did yoga throughout her pregnancy. So I said, oh, if you have done yoga even in the last trimester, then you must have had a normal delivery. You must have had the strength and you must have been fit enough to have a normal delivery. So you know what she said? No, 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 I didn't want to take the risk of having a normal delivery. So we are in a state where people think that operation is safe, cesarean is safe, but having a normal delivery is a risky process. So anyone who's had a surgery knows that they take risk consent signature for any, even the smallest minor operation. And in that, cesarean is actually quite a big abdominal surgery which is being done. But we think that that is safe, but the normal natural process of birthing is a risky process. So this is the state we are in today. So this hormone imbalance continues and causes the most problem in the age of menopause. The age where all the cycles should be stopping, and we'll come to doubts later.
Just one information. Yes. Sir, I have 7 grandchildren. Out of 7 grandchildren, 5 children were born at home, natural delivery, home delivery. They were not shown to any gynecologist doctor. No medicines were given during the time of pregnancy. And the delivery was done at home. And even after that, no vaccination thing. Still now they've been free from any medications. And first baby was born in the hospital, it was a cesarean case. And the second baby, what she conceived was, delivery was done in 1.3, she conceived soon after the 1 year and 3 months. So soon after the cesarean,
again, had to go in.
1 year and 3 months, she conceived, and the delivery was normal at home.
Okay.
Second is a normal baby at home, even in spite of the first being a cesarean. So all the 5 children were born at home, natural delivery, no medication, no gynecologist, no reports, no scanning, nothing was done.
Very rare to find such occurrences now. So next, moving on to menopause, the age when the whole hormone balance is actually in a delicate state. Even naturally it is in a delicate state, and we have complicated it further by the entire process having a being throughout the sexually phase we have had hormone imbalance, and that period becomes even more delicate. So with the age of menarche receding, we are also seeing that the age of menopause is also receding. By the age of 40, 41, 42 itself, menopause is being attained. So most women say, okay, this is very good. I anyway want to get rid of these cycles. I am fed up of having to go through these cycles every month. It's such a big burden. So good if it is over early. But what you're forgetting is that this cycles happening regularly was giving you a natural protection from heart disease. Earlier, women never had heart attacks during your age, before the menopause. It was almost never seen for women to have heart attacks. Men are more prone to heart attacks because these female hormones are giving you protection from it. Women up to the age of menopause are also having protection of having strong bones. After menopause is the time when your bones start becoming weak. So if you are having an early menopause, you are giving an invitation to heart problems early, and you're giving an invitation to weakening of your bones, joint pains, joint complaints, all at an earlier age. So the next thing which we need to discuss about is that the steroids are not just given to the cows through injections, but also mixed in their feed. So even if you are talking about a desi cow, unless you are sure that the cow is feeding on natural substances is grazing or is having unadulterated substances. The feed which is found in the market itself for cows is mixed with these chemicals and with these steroids. So even if it is a desi cow giving milk, if it is not feeding on natural substances, you are going to get affected by the steroids present in the milk. So if the only situation where very few people are lucky enough to have a desi cow's milk directly accessible to them, being sure that the cow is having only natural feed, and if you can be sure that they are giving the milk to the calf first and then collecting the milk, will it be possible for us to take that milk? How many of us can have that assurance? Is it really possible? So very few lucky people who have that. And again, in those people, ensure that you are not getting it in a plastic bottle or a plastic packet. So even if yeah, I'm coming to that. So if all this is ensured and you are able to get that milk, health-wise, it is not going to cause a problem for you. But of course, we have already seen the environmental aspects of it. So another point which I like to bring up is, many people say that our scriptures have given that milk is good for us, and you are saying that it is not. So as I already said, when we were talking about garlic and hing being substances which induce milk secretion, we have to talk about milk, which was referred to as a medicinal substance in most of our scriptures. So if we start using a medicinal substance day in and day out, 365 days of a year, we start getting immune to it and we do not perceive it, our body does not perceive it in its medicinal value anymore. So it is always best to use substances which are like milk. It is, yes, there are some good things in it on an occasional basis and not on a regular basis if you want to get any medicinal benefit which is available in it. So even our millets, so they have medicinal properties. So that is why we are saying, don't eat the same millet every single day. So if you're following it in a cycle, if I eat kodo millet today, I'm going to eat it only after 8 more days minimum break. So then it is not going to stop acting as a medicine, and it is going to act as a food as well in my body.
So how to avoid this?
Yes. So the next question is, where do we get our calcium from? So it has been imprinted in all our minds that milk, calcium, milk is the complete food, we get calcium from milk. But can anyone tell me how much calcium is present in milk?
Not even 1 gram per liter. Less than 1 gram.
So 100 grams of milk has 125 mg of calcium. And let me tell you, not all of this is absorbed in the body. It contains this much when it is there. Actually, to speak the truth, we do not have the capacity to digest milk after the age of 5 years. Till 5, every human being has the enzymes required for digestion of milk. But after 5, that disappears in our body. So in order to be able to digest milk after the age of 5, it has to first be converted into the form of curd within our gut by the lactobacilli present inside our intestine, and only then can it be digested. Only then can we absorb anything from it. So it would be best to directly convert it to curd. The remaining milk which we have, the desi milk, which is not present in plastic, which we get in glass or steel vessels, to convert it in the form of curd and then into buttermilk and consume it as and when required. This would be the best way to do it. And then we can make ghee from it.
That the hormones will not affect.
So So bacterial action can change everything except plastic. We already saw the bacteria can act upon hormones, can act upon chemicals, can it is the bacteria which degrade everything, even in the soil. So lactobacilli reduce to a very great extent the steroid present in the milk and the chemicals which are added. Suppose some chemicals have been added, the bacterial action reduces all of that and gives us only the goodness of it and removes the bad aspect. Can also be used in the form of ghee. So ghee is also prepared after fermentation. So ghee is also okay. As milk, it is best to be avoided. So where can we get calcium from? This is another one of the scientific myths which we were talking about. To eliminate the local food and create an idea only about the things which companies find favorable to promote. Companies want to sell.
So nowadays I see almost all the milkmen, they keep the milk either in aluminium vessel or the plastic vessel. They don't use any other vessel than that.
Yes.
How it is good, whether it is...
It is not good. Yeah, that's what I said. If you can ensure that it is in either steel or in glass, only then will it be good for you. So, there are many local sources of calcium, better sources of calcium than milk. For example, in 100 grams of sesame, this is milk. There is 1000 milligrams of calcium. But no one speaks about it as a source of calcium. Sitafal, which is a seasonal fruit, very tasty fruit, is also a very rich source of calcium. Yes. Our 5 positive millets, Siridhanya, also contain calcium.
And so, the richest source of calcium.
Yes.
Lotus stem.
Yes. Yes.
That 100 grams is close to 500 mg calcium.
Okay. Very tasty way of taking it. So, okay, lotus stem. I let me get the numbers again. 100 grams. Okay. Okay. From the stem, the seeds which we get. Okay. Yes.
It's around 500 mg. We give it to weaning children.
Okay.
As a powder form when they are 6 months old, then you can start giving.
Okay. So I will be adding this for my next lectures. Yes, the fruit.
The very nice fruit.
Yes. Custard apple. So there are several other sources of calcium which has been wiped out from our zone of knowledge, and we think only milk is the source of calcium.
There is one more thing that I want to add here. The recommended dietary allowance for calcium per day for children is around 300 to 500, depending upon the 300 to 800, I can say. And for an adult, it is around 1000 to 1200. So we can easily get that if we just use our
local sources. Correct, exactly. And similar, very similar to the FDA regarding chocolate, also the FDA permits 750 million pus cells per liter of milk, permitted value of pus cells. So we are thinking we are taking good milk, but we are actually having 750 million pus cells per liter. So who likes to take in pus? So infected products. Yes. So this cow is prone to get mastitis because lactation is supposed to be for a limited period, but in our greed, we are making the cows produce milk 365 days of a year almost, except for some days during the pregnancy. As soon as it is the milk is reducing, it is again sent in for fertilization, becomes pregnant, and again the process of milking starts. So this continuous process, along with the usage of the steroids, is making the cows prone to mastitis, infection of the breast of the cow. And this makes pus cells prevalent to a great number, and the FDA permits 750 million pus cells in the milk. So next, let's move on to...
Melamine also permits in FDA.
Yes.
FDA permits melamine, that is a plastic.
Many things. Many things which we would not like to know are permitted.
I have one question. It's a little controversial, but still I'll ask. The hormonal imbalance causing, breast in boys. Can we look at, again, this little controversial, excuse me for it, but LGBT phenomenon that is getting developed.
I didn't get, please so expand.
LGBT, lesbian, gay.
Okay.
So can that be attributed to the milk going on in the food supply?
Probably. I cannot say with, yes, there are
chances.
Yes, of course, the hormones becoming not the way they should be can lead to such phenomena happen. Yes.
Can this be a root cause?
Probably. We'll have to look more deeper into that aspect. Okay, so we are moving on to an even more controversial topic, which is meat. So we already have listed the environmental reason. And of course, there is the humane or the compassion reason, which is sufficient for some people, but not maybe sufficient for everyone to quit something which they find so tasty and enjoy a lot. So let's look into the other reasons which we need to consider when we consider eating meat. So how is meat being produced now, today, on the planet? How is the production of meat happening? We already saw that there are 100 billion chicken present on the earth on any given day. So let's talk about chicken as an example. The same applies in greater or lesser proportions to the other forms of meat as well. So in order to grow chicken, we have poultry farms. Anyone visited a poultry farm?
My district is number one in the country, madam, Chittoor district.
Okay. So we have people who have poultry farms very in their vicinity, surrounding near their homes. So it will be less than this area, not even this much area, each poultry farm. And there are hundreds of chicken which are put into it without any space to even move. So this is how it is. There is.
I've seen a better one.
You've seen a better one.
I mean, scientifically managed. I mean, as far as.
Okay.
Huge one.
Okay.
Small ones are done now, even in our district.
Okay.
They're raising out.
Okay.
Doing it in a large scale.
Okay.
But earlier, when the small one was there, the harvest time used to be any time around 80 days to 90 days for 1.5 to 2 kg of.
Okay.
Now, for the same, it is not more than 37 days precisely for the 1.5 to 2 kg chicken.
Okay, so then they must.
After 38 days, the grower who is responsible for that is giving, after 38 days, they will discount it from his production capability. That
okay.
Means he will get
less money.
Less money.
Okay.
So that is a competition.
Okay.
So they will feed all his
okay.
37 days, they make sure.
We are speaking about chicken and we have it. Okay, so the whole intention of saying that it is in a small area, whether it is that small or not, being present, the same species in a very small area makes you more prone to disease. So earlier we used to have the, what do you call, chatre, all the people coming together for, Mela, okay, fairs, Mela, whatever. So in the name of God or some other reason, everyone used to come together, and this used to be the most critical period for communicable diseases, because when a large number of people of the same species, any organism it can be, even plants in agriculture, if there is monocropping, very closely spaced plants, they become more prone to disease because they require the same kind of nutrients from the soil, and the competition is so much that they start harming each other and get prone to disease. So chicken, when they are grown in this artificial way, I already said that it is actually a very rare bird, but then we are breeding it and multiplying them in number just for our consumption. So when there are so many of them present in a small area, they become prone to disease, and they're inviting bacteria and viruses. So the first thing is, there are a large number of bacteria and virus being present. As he just mentioned now, the lifespan, which actually was supposed to be 2 years, a chicken is supposed to become an adult, a chick is supposed to become an adult at 2 years, but we want to fast forward things. We cannot wait for 2 years in order to harvest that meat. So what do? We make them become adults faster by injecting them again with steroids. So what happens when we inject the steroids? Steroids make you put on weight. Anyone who would have used steroid medication, say for a skin problem or for their asthma, will know that when they take steroids, there is a tendency to put on weight. So these chicken are injected with steroids in the greed to make them grow faster, and they eat continuously, keep eating, and they put on weight. So because of these steroids, what happens? A side effect of steroid usage is fall in the immunity levels. The steroids suppress your immunity directly by reducing the white blood cell activity and also suppressing the bone marrow. So these chicken, which are growing very soon, have not even got the chance to develop their bones. If you see, they might not even be able to stand on their feet because their bones are so weak and they are so heavy that they are actually lying on their abdomen and cannot even move properly. This is how they have been grown. So we also know that where does the immunity come from? From the bone marrow. So these steroids suppressing the bone marrow, and the urgency to grow them, not giving time for the bone to even develop properly, makes the chicken have a very low immunity. And also we are already seen that bacteria and viruses are being invited because of the unhygienic ways in which they are grown, and because of the dense population of them being present in a small area. So we are forced to use antibiotics. How much of antibiotics is being used? The permitted antibiotic dosage in a human being for up to 22 to 23 years. This much of antibiotic is given to chicken within their short lifespan of 2 to 3 months. So the same dosage of antibiotic. So if we actually go according to the textbook, if we take antibiotics once, for the next 6 months we are not supposed to be prescribed or supposed to take antibiotics again. That is the kind of effect it has in our body. But what we should have, we could, the maximum dosage which can be used in a human being as prescribed by the textbooks for 22 to 23 years is given to the chicken within their short lifespan. So when we consume chicken, we are consuming the antibiotics overloaded. we are consuming the steroid, and also we are still okay. So the antibiotics would have acted and killed the bacteria. Let us say it has been successful in killing all the bacteria. But what about the viruses? These still do not have any effective medicine which acts on viruses, even in human beings, let alone in the chicken. So the next thing which people say when I say this is, viruses are very host specific organisms. So the virus which has infected a chicken will not have any effect on me. Yes, this is a true statement, but then as we already said, viruses have the capacity to mutate very soon. They have a very short lifespan, which makes them very easy. It is very easy for them to mutate and change. So these viruses, when they enter your body, they have an easy tendency to mutate very quickly and change their form into such a way that they can infect a human being as well. So this is what is happening, and this is one of the main reasons why we are leading into infections like the bird flu. We all know about the H1N1 disaster which has happened. The same is regarding the swine flu. The same was regarding the mad cow disease. The unscientific ways in which we are growing meat has made such microorganisms become stronger and stronger day by day, and they are spreading to such a great extent and mutating in a way that they can infect us, and even we are afraid that they will be a cause, one of the main causes for which can probably eliminate the entire human race because of the antibiotics which we are using in such a great dosage. We are leading to development of antibiotic resistance. This in itself is a very alarming, very scary situation. So when the microbes are repeatedly introduced into an environment with antibiotics, they mutate. Like I said, how the DNA was introduced into soybean in order to counteract the chemical weedicide which was being sprayed. In the same way, the bacteria develops a small mutation and produces an enzyme which will be able to counteract the antibiotic which is given. This is the reason we are having to update and upgrade the antibiotics every year. The antibiotics which were effective last year will not be effective this year because the bacteria has mutated and has become resistant to it. So we are creating microorganisms which are stronger and stronger each day, and which we are not able to keep up with the rate at which antibiotic resistance is developing. We are not able to develop new medicines at the same rate at which they are becoming stronger. So it is possible that such an infection, if it breaks out, it may be able to wipe out the whole human existence, and this is a prediction which has been made.
We have to feed all the birds and cows with the millets.
Yes, they love the food. So antibiotic resistance is also a major factor. For antibiotic resistance is not just the unregulated usage in human beings, but also the unrestricted use of it in poultry and in other meat cultivation. So let us add antibiotics which we are ingesting. So what happens if we ingest excess antibiotics? We are going to destroy the good bacteria in our gut as well. The antibiotics will not differentiate between good bacteria and bad bacteria. So the probiotics in our intestine are lost, and thus we have the problems of, we already saw, vitamin deficiency in B12 we discussed is because of not having a good intestinal flora. That is just one. So the good bacteria are the first line of defense in our body. If they are not there, our immunity levels are dropping. We are inviting bad bacteria if there are no good bacteria present in our gut. So then is the steroids, and then is the virus and bacteria. So when we talk about all this, the next question people ask is, okay, let me avoid chicken, let me avoid mutton. How about egg? I think I can have egg. This is the next question which comes up. So at least in a chicken, there was some life to resist the bacteria, to resist the virus. There was some immune system in place. There was a life to act against these. But how are eggs produced now? Eggs, there is no fertilized egg being produced. Electric shock, and it is the egg produced without fertilization. So there is no life in it at all. There is all the substrate which is required for bacterial growth and for viral growth, but there is no life form inside it to fight against it. So it is a potential haven for bacteria and viruses. So eating egg is equivalent to consuming, inviting diseases for ourselves. Yes, so next, the next question is, okay, I will avoid all this. So how about fish? Okay, yeah. Okay, so we will not have poultry which is grown in the poultry farms. What about the desi type of chicken which is grown in the naturally? So these bacteria and viruses have been found in the blood of the penguin present in Antarctica. This is the extent to which we have allowed the bacteria and viruses to grow. It is present in the blood of the Siberian, cranes. Yes, they migrate, they're migratory birds which come from Siberia every year to India during the, when it is too cold there, they come here. So such migratory processes have helped the viruses and bacteria to spread even till Antarctica. So it is for sure that the country chicken which is growing right next to the poultry farms, even though it is able to run around, is sure to have the same bacteria and viruses. It is not possible to contain the infection only to a small region. We have had to kill millions of chicken just because they were infected, and yet we could not prevent the spread of H1N1, such a deadly disease. So it's the same in the country fowl which sir is asking about. So next question was, what about fish? I think many people are here who like fish. So how are fish being grown now? You know what they are fed with? All the poultry farm waste which is being produced, the shit of chicken, is all swept, collected and put into the ponds for growing fish. This is what they are eating. So of course it contains all of this as well. The shit of chicken will contain all of this, and it is directly going into the fish. There is no difference in the chemicals used for fish culturing, for prawn culturing, is unbelievable. You will not be able to believe the amount of chemicals they use in order to keep them alive in that artificial conditions. Earlier, I think fish were the fastest animals. So when Arjuna had to be tested on his archery skills, he was asked to hit the eye of a fish which was there in the pond. So if you could do that, you are a very great person. You have very good skills, because the fish moves so quickly. But now you don't even need a fishing rope. You can, that is how sluggish and slow they are, because of how they are being fed and because of what they are eating. So this is, you will, next, the people are, I know the next question coming is, okay, let's not have the farm fish, let's not have the farm prawns. What about that which comes from the river catch or from the ocean catch? Wild catch. So where does all our industrial waste go? Yes, it all goes into the ocean. So the most scary thing about eating fish from even the ocean is that all the lead and the mercury, the heavy metals which we are dumping into the ocean, gets concentrated in the fish body. So they are heavy metals which are highly toxic to us, which will damage our kidney, damage the brain, damage the nerves, damage the bone marrow. All these are present in high concentrations in fish. Yes, there are some good elements in the, according to the dietary charts, there are some very nutritional elements in fish, but it is not worth to eat it for that and get poisoned with the heavy metals, which are very, very toxic to us. There is no difference, sir. There is, on a very similar level, probably a little less intensity, all this happens equally in sheep, goat, cows, pigs, all the same. The feed itself usually has, okay, grazed naturally, but infections, how will you prevent? Okay.
Fish also, they give hormones.
Yes.
Breeding.
Yes.
Otherwise, they don't
grow so play. Fast. Yeah. Yes.
Then make a barbecue, all bacteria virus dies.
And that can be answered with the weedicide, right? The entire weedicide, you know, the chemical used for dioxin, the dioxins, you know, sprayed in the main crops, right? That gets into the water system.
Biomagnification. So I think, as we said, 1 kg what is chemical present, 8 kgs of it is required for feeding the animal, and all the toxin in 8 kgs gets biomagnified in the meat. So the toxic load is much heavier when you are consuming meat. So we have reasons in order to stop eating meat, but of course the choice is yours. You know now what you are doing, and it is left to you what you choose to do. Okay, so I think we will stop with this. So I would like to thank Surya. Where is Bob? Sleeping now. Okay, first we tired. And Bali, for the first time organizing here, they have, I think, reached near perfection levels, which is very difficult to do. I have seen how difficult it is to organize an event, and they have done a very good job. And the interest which they have taken to bring us here. So many people, when we talk to them, they listen to us, they say, okay, we want to organize something similar, would you come? So the very first time he came and he told me, ma'am, I want to do it in Mumbai. Will you come? Would you be interested to come? He said yes, but I never actually thought that it will happen, because so many people ask us about it, but it rarely materializes into a program. Yes. So we need to give them a big round of applause for this. And it happened so quickly, not even, I think, 2-3 months we had the program fixed. So it didn't even take a long time for it to materialize. And they have done a very good job. So I wanted to thank them. And for me, the plus point is being able to interact with so many people, so many different people from different regions, and having their own backgrounds, and being able to interact with everyone is what I enjoy in this whole process. And of course, if I reach someone, if I help someone change, the pleasure is all mine. Okay. So with this, I want to conclude saying that I hope all of us have gone a few steps closer to nature in this process, and that it doesn't stop here and we continue in this journey. And I hope to meet you all soon in your own places where the people have been saying they will organize. We would look forward to meeting you there. Okay, thank you.